So in today's class, what we are going to see is actually the junction breakdown, the concept of junction breakdown. Okay, so that is one thing that we are going to see. And previous to that, we'll just recap what we learned in the class, and then we'll reinforce the learning of the previous class through a problem. Okay, so before we go into the junction breakdown on today. So what we learned in the last class was about the current voltage relationship. Okay, in general, it is applicable to both forward bias and reverse bias. And we derived an expression as current equal to the expression for the current I equal to Is exponential of V by Vt minus 1, where so this is a steady state current under forward bias. So where Is is actually called as saturation current, or scale current. So why the names like this? We also saw that. Anyway, I'm going to scale current. Okay, why the name is like this? Saturation current. Okay, let me see this expression for Is. Let me rewrite it. So what we have is A Q N I square D P by L P, and it will be the donor impurity N D plus D N by L N N A. Okay, so this is the expression for the Is, and you can see that so current, you know that unit of current is measured in amperes. Okay, so milliampere is 10 power minus 3, microampere is 10 power minus 6, nanoampere is 10 power minus 9, picoampere is 10 power minus 12. Okay, and femto is minus 15, right? So now what we saw was the current voltage relationship, and we came up with this plot. Okay, just a minute. So fairly okay, and so the y axis is the current I, and x axis is the applied voltage V. Okay, so V applied, so it could be either forward bias from positive values of V. For the negative values, it will be the reverse bias. So you already know what is forward bias and reverse bias. So this is my PN junction, and the forward bias is this is P, this is N. The positive terminal of the source connected to the P-type material, and this is forward bias, which allows the majority carrier on either side of the junction to diffuse easily, constituting the current flow. So obviously the majority carrier are participating. So the current that we are going to get under forward bias is going to be pretty high. Okay, so what is this pretty high order? That will be typically of the order of milliampere, 2 ampere. So depending on the applied voltage and depending on the rating, so this is like the exponential dependence. But when in the reverse bias, so this is forward bias. Okay, so when in the reverse bias, what is going to happen? When in the reverse bias, think about this, V is smaller. So let us go to the next page. I'll come back to this. So I have expression I equal to Is exponential of V by Vt minus 1. The whole term is multiplied by Is. Now, when V is negative, it implies reverse bias. So this for reverse bias, the same expression is I equal to Is exponential of minus V divided by Vt, where Vt is the thermal voltage. At room temperature, the value is 25.9 milli electron volt. So when this is exponential decay, because it's a negative function, which means for V, okay, for V greater than, much greater than Vt, so I already told you Vt is actually the thermal voltage. Thermal voltage, and Vt is actually 25.9 milli electron volt. So for V much greater than Vt, I am talking about magnitude. Then this term, this negative sign, so this term is going to be smaller. So the exponential term will become very small, because it's a negative. Because you can write 1 by e power minus x as 1 by e power x, and e power x being quite large, 1 by e power x will be much small. So exponential term with the negative sign is, it's implied, I am writing it so that you can understand clearly, with the negative sign is smaller, which means I can neglect that term in comparison to 1. In comparison to 1, it is going to be much smaller. So I will become nearly equal to minus Is for sufficient voltages under reverse bias greater than thermal voltage. So my drawing in the reverse bias goes like this. So initially, as I increase, so it will attain a constant value. And so these are some kind of a in the reverse bias. So the voltages are in the negative sign. Okay. So the Is, the reverse current, we call the reverse current. Acquires a constant value And you know, under reverse bias, the minority carriers contribute to the flow of current. So the minority carriers is going to be small. Therefore, for voltages up to certain value, I will come to that. Why I use the word certain value? So under reverse bias, for voltages up to a certain value, much greater than the VT, the reverse current acquires a constant value, and that constant value is actually, that is why, because it is acquiring a constant value, we call this current as saturation current. The name saturation current comes from the, it is saturating for the reverse voltages, okay, exceeding that of, sufficiently exceeding that of the thermal voltages. So this name saturation is because of this constant. But how long this constant value? That is the question we need to understand. So how long this constant value? Now what about the scale current? That is something which I did not tell you. So we need to see that. So if you look at, I have written the reverse current, either it is called saturation current or scale current. Now look at the expression for IS. IS actually scales with the, IS scales with the area of cross section of the PN junction. So IS scales with the area of cross section of PN junction. Area of cross section of PN junction. Which means this current, as the area increases, IS will increase proportional to the area of cross section. Therefore, this current under reverse bias of the PN junction is also known as scale current. Okay, so this is the reasons for the nomenclature of the current that is flowing across the junction under reverse bias. Okay, so that is one thing. Now how long, the question that should strike you is how long this current is constant. This is the question. So how long that scale current will be constant? Now, as I keep increasing the reverse bias voltage at a particular value of reverse bias, voltage denoted as V subscript Z. Okay, V subscript Z, where the Z stands for Zener. Okay, the earliest person who worked on this phenomena. Okay, what is that phenomena? We'll come to that. At a particular value of reverse bias voltage denoted as VZ, V equal to VC, and remember this is actually negative because it's a reverse bias, so don't forget that. We notice the reverse current increases rapidly. How? Rapidly. So how do I see that in the plot? So this value, so right now this current, what you see is your IS current. Now beyond a certain value, it increases rapidly. The rapidly can be either like this sharp increase. Okay, sorry, it is not like this plot has to be drawn properly, otherwise it's not correct. So it increases either rapidly, okay, so assume like this, or it increases like this sometime like this, or it can also go like this. Okay, so either a sharp fall or some gradual, or it can be even much longer like this. It all depends on how the PN junction is fabricated. So the fabrication parameters that ensures the doping levels will decide whether the rapid increase in the current, so this also reverse current, that is why it is negative, the current flowing in opposite direction to that of the forward bias current. Okay, and this current can increase rapidly even for very small increase in the reverse voltage. Okay, I have actually drawn up with a little bit of this thing, so it can go like this, constant can extend further, and then it can go like this, or constant can extend and then it can go like this. So it all depends on how that PN junctions have been fabricated. So we'll come to that. So at a particular value of reverse bias voltage denoted as VC, we notice the reverse current increases rapidly. This rapid increase with very minimal increase in applied reverse bias voltage, is okay, this phenomenon of rapid increase with minimal increase in applied reverse bias voltage is known as junction breakdown. Now breakdown is generally denoted for something that is broken, right? So that is the phenomena. So we see that any voltages exceeding even very small amount, okay, above that of VC, the current rises rapidly. What is this order of current? The order of reverse current, again, depends on the diode parameters and applied voltage. The order of reverse current, actually it depends mainly on the doping levels. Okay, so the order of reverse current is typically -10^-6 to 10^, can be typically of this order. Okay, typically of this order, it all depends. 10^-6, maybe in the last class I said nanoamperes to 10^-12 to 10^-18, but you can also get it microamperes. Okay, so these microampere 10^, so don't please correct it. So it could be microamperes too. Okay, I will tell you in which situation we will get microamperes. there are different types of diode, PN junction diodes made out of PN junction. Diodes are mainly PN junction, and there are different types of diodes, and depending on that you can get microampere or you can even get picoamperes. Okay, so this is typically the order of reverse current. But now the question comes, breakdown corresponds to, you know, something you say bus broken, breakdown. Okay, the breakdown means some equipment become faulty or something. But here we refer the junction breakdown, most often we use under reverse bias in the breakdown region. Okay, most often the PN junction, so that is something not normally heard, right? So breakdown you are saying, but then why are you operating the PN junction under the breakdown? So PN junction is operated, of course, that goes without saying, breakdown happens only under reverse bias. In the breakdown region. So the question immediately comes, will the PN junction not get damaged? So the answer to that is, we can easily operate the PN junction, okay, provided we know safely, okay, we can easily operate the PN junction under reverse bias in the breakdown region. Safe repeatedly without damaging the PN junction. How? The reason is for that every PN junction has certain specifications of power rating and the breakdown voltage. I repeat, every PN junction fabricated has a certain specifications that come with when you buy a diode, for example. We'll come to the concept of diode soon. So the PN junction, every PN junction when you buy, you will have a specifications of power rating and the breakdown voltage. Okay, so if you start to apply at that breakdown voltage, the power rating specifies how much current that PN junction can accommodate, as long as you are within that current limit. So because we know power is nothing but I square R, or simply VA, and I know what is the value of VC. So definitely I will be able to tell how much current it can withstand this PN junction. So as long as I operate at the breakdown voltage such that the current is controlled by the external circuit. Remember, you don't operate a PN junction simply like that. Okay, you always put current limiting resistors you always include. In the circuit are employed to ensure safe repetitive operation of PN junction. So we operate under reverse bias in the breakdown region only. That is when we can get maximum current out of it. Okay, so as long as I know the ratings, so that is what you have to understand. Now, what are the mechanisms behind the breakdown? Began the junction breakdown. Okay, so mechanisms, there are two types of mechanisms. One is called avalanche breakdown, the other is called Zener breakdown. So remember, for example, let us say I have a p-n junction like this. This is my the step between the abrupt step or the abrupt junction between p-type material and n-type, forming a junction. And here I am connecting it to reverse bias. So p is connected to the negative of the source and n is connected to the positive of the source. Now we know the barrier potential increases under reverse bias. So this is under reverse bias. Barrier potential increases under reverse bias and it becomes V naught plus V. I call it as VR. So definitely it is higher than V naught, greater than V naught. So barrier potential increases where naught stands for equilibrium value. Okay, so this is one thing. Second thing is actually we also know that the depletion width as a result increases. Depletion region, depletion width increases. Now avalanche breakdown, let us talk about it. What happens is actually we know that there are minority carriers, okay, on both sides. Thermally generated minority carriers exist. Thermally generated minority carriers, thermally generated minority carriers. So the minority carriers are electrons on the p side and holes on the n side. Thermally exist. So what happens is there is a field. So let us look at avalanche breakdown. The thermally generated minority carriers, acquire sufficiently high kinetic energy. Kinetic energy because of the existence of the electric field, under the influence of the electric field. Because electric field is nothing but voltage applied per the width. Okay, width increases, no problem, but the voltage is rising because it is V naught plus VR. So under the influence of the field, the thermally generated minority carriers acquire sufficiently high kinetic energy and these thermally generated minority carriers, okay, cross over the junction. As they cross over the junction, okay, they actually collide, okay, with the atoms. Okay, when they collide with the atoms, what they do is they knock out electron or hole. Okay, it is actually the electron that is being knocked out, and the electron when they knock out, actually we see that so it is like this. So I have like silicon atom like this, and it forms covalent bond. So I only draw the valence electron. Okay, it extends like this. Okay, we are not drawing. Okay, I have drawn only representative, so it extends. Okay, so the crystal extends. So this is my silicon, and the valence electrons are there, and so they participate. Now, when this thermally generated carrier come with kinetic energy and collide with this atom, what they do is they break the covalent bonds. Okay, so sufficient, and they undergo collisions with the atoms as they cross over the junction. So when they do that, in the process they undergo collisions with the atoms. Okay, they means basically these electrons, charge carriers. Okay, so they undergo collisions with the atoms as they cross over the junction, and which leads to ionization, which leads to breaking of the covalent bonds, and thus ionization. Because once the covalent bonds are broken, then the electron, the valence electron is liberated. So when the valence electron is liberated, and that valence electron also will acquire sufficient kinetic energy under the influence of the field. So because the covalent bond is broken, no more it is bonded to the lattice atom, therefore it is coming out of it and it is available for conduction. So which leads to breaking of the covalent bonds and ionization of the atoms. Ionization of the atoms, and these knocked out valence electrons. These knocked out valence electrons gain sufficient energy, because it's an energy in motion, so we call it kinetic energy. So sufficient kinetic energy, and they in turn generate more carriers. Okay, they in turn generate more carriers. generate more charge carriers in the similar manner, more electron hole pairs. Charge carrier means electron hole pairs, electron hole in similar manner. So it is actually breaking off. So in a nutshell, what I need to say is in similar manner. The initiation is caused by minority carriers. So in a nutshell, if I were to put it in a flow chart, I will say minority carriers with sufficient energy, with kinetic energy, undergo collision. Collisions with atoms, and then knocking out, and the ionization, it leads to ionization, and the valence electron is set free. That valence electrons in turn do the valence electron knocked out. Available for conduction, knocked out. But this process goes on and on, that it will again leads to further collisions. So it will, the loop is formed like here. The loop is right over here. Again, it collides with atoms, and again, other atoms are ionized. Again, more valence electrons are released. It happens, and they cross over the junction. Therefore, it is like an avalanche process. So this repetitive process, of ionization and generation, of more charge carriers under reverse bias. Of course, it's all reverse bias only. I keep stressing that under reverse bias of PN junction, leads to avalanche breakdown. So covalent bond. So collisions with atoms leading to ionization via breaking of covalent bonds. Now you got to understand, these are the minority carrier that is coming out. So this process is going to be will lead to a kind of current voltage behavior. We'll see that. So leads to avalanche breakdown. Now on the other hand, so what is this Zener breakdown? Again, breakdown only under reverse bias. So under reverse bias of the PN junction, what here happens is actually the PN junction is so specially fabricated, with typical parameters of very high doping, of both P and N materials, Now, when I heavily doped both P and N material, the depletion width the depletion width of the junction, because both are heavily doped. What will be the depletion width? Depletion width of the junction will be very small. Depletion width of the junction will be very small. Okay, so the depletion width of the junction will be very small because of heavy doping. Concentration is very high. The equilibrium sets the barrier so quickly that the width is very narrow on either side. Because we talked about P plus N junction or P N plus junction, we saw that on the lightly doped side, the junction width extends more than the heavily doped. But if both are heavily doped, then the junction width becomes very small. And if the junction width is smaller, the depletion width, I am talking about the depletion width. If the depletion width is smaller, then the electric field in this depletion region, will be very high. Electric field in this depletion region will be very high for a given applied reverse bias, because electric field is nothing but the potential applied per the width of the depletion. Now if the denominator is very small, then naturally electric field in the depletion region will be very high for a given applied reverse voltage. Okay, so electric field in the depletion region will be very high. Now think about this. So what happens is, here the electric field itself is responsible for pulling the charge carriers and enabling crossover to the rapid crossover to the or swift crossover across the junction. So what happens is, actually the electric field itself generates electron hole pairs. This very high electric field will, generate electron hole pairs because field is very high. So electric field under reverse bias. Okay, now think about this. You look at this picture. If you look at this PN junction, the P majority carrier is electron holes, and N the majority carrier is electrons. Now under reverse bias, the electrons will be, actually it's a reverse current. So you will see that normally the current will be from here to here, because the electrons will be coming and the junction width, the depletion width. But the electron, you have to think, it is heavily doped condition, that it will be able to generate more electron hole pairs and very swiftly. And therefore, because it generate very swiftly, this is very important. So very swiftly, causing the electrons move towards the N side and holes move towards readily to the P side, constituting current, reverse current. The electrons move towards N side and the holes move towards P side. move towards P seat. Okay, so once zener starts, once this mechanism starts, once zener starts, okay, which means we have applied a reverse bias voltage close to the value of VC. Once that is when we say it is kicking on. Okay, so you look at here, this picture, right here is the VC value. Close to this is the VC value. Of course, the VC value will be dependent on the, will be different for different types of PN junction, which means different doping levels. So the VC value, once the onset of the zener breakdown begins, okay, once that begins, okay, a large number of carriers get generated. A large number carriers, a large number, because of heavy doping actually, a large number of carriers get generated easily, generated swiftly, that there is a rapid rise in the, sharp rise in the current, that it leads to sharp rise in current. Now, so you can see, if there is a gradual slope, if there is a gradual increase in comparison to that of the sharp increase that is seen in zener, then you can say that actually it is avalanche breakdown. Okay, so to sum it up, it is like this. So it can, in the reverse only I am drawing, so it leads to here. So I am hitting this VC value, then if it goes like this, or then we call it as, this is zener breakdown. This kind of observation is a zener breakdown, which means sharp increase. Even for very small increase in VC value, there is a operating regime. The VC is the breakdown voltage. Now, if it leads further, and then it goes like this, not a sharp increase like this, then it is avalanche. So this is the summary of this breakdown. So this avalanche breakdown. Okay, so you can see the difference here. So sharp increase. Why sharp increase? Because large number of carriers generated as a result of the electric field, which is very high because of heavy doping. Okay, heavy doping definitely will constitute more charge carriers will be available. So you have to understand. But whereas avalanche breakdown begins with minority carriers, which undergoes collisions with the atoms, knocking out the valence electron and leading to ionization. Here there is no ionization phenomena. The phenomena is different in zener. The phenomena is generally the field itself is able to pull the electron, and the electron readily cross over, and the holes also cross over, so leading to electron volt pair generation, a reverse current flows. Okay, a reverse current will be in the opposite direction of the current in the forward bias. That is the reverse current. Okay, I think I have said enough. And then, so you can understand that generally, if you look at most of the PN junction, if it is around VC around 5, it will be zener breakdown when these kind of values are given. But if VC is very high, that it can be very high for general purpose PN junction, which will be lightly doped, relatively lightly doped comparison to heavily doped. When we say heavily doped, it will be of the order of 10 power plus 18 per centimeter cube carrier concentration. Okay, donor atoms. Okay, 10 power 18 per centimeter cube or 10 power 19. But if it's of the order of 10 power 14 or 10 power 15, then it is lightly doped general purpose PN junction, in which case it can go all the way from greater than 7 volt, and it can go higher, even higher. So it will be specified, and power rating will also be specified. so that you know how to operate in safe levels. I think I have said enough. Thank you very much. I hope you have understood this breakdown concept. In the afternoon, we'll do some problems on the IV characteristics so as to understand this concept of the forward bias current and the reverse bias current. Okay, just a second.